things like me.
So, I'd like to know a little bit about you. So please raise your hands. Who's Java developer?
Is there anyone else?
Everyone of Java developers work with Java, right? Raise your hand. How many of you already tried Java 9? Okay, that's good. I want to focus on common Java developer, so I will not go too much details, but just I want to mention things that I think are important for everyday Java developer. So, two more questions for you. What was Java 8 about? Main feature.
Streams and lambdas.
Yeah. Streams are possible because of lambdas. Yeah. And what's the key feature of Java 9?
Jigsaw.
Modularization.
Okay. That's correct. But there are many more. There are new tools. New APIs, some language changes, some internal changes, also some removals and deprecations, and many more. So current state of Java 9 is it's in ramdown phase, which means that it's feature complete, just some high priority bugs are approved, and it should be GA, general available 27th of July. It was actually postponed, I think, two times, but this should be really the date. And I have another really fresh information that actually new forests for JDK 10 was created just yesterday. So I don't have to here because it's really fresh. Okay, I would like to start with version string scheme that was changed because if you look what's this is example from Java 8. What's numbers of versions? 74, 77, 91, 92, 101. It doesn't make much sense. And what's more wrong is the long version of it. Because as you can see, it's 1.8.0 and it holds just one information, that it's Java 8. And actually, 101 holds two information. It's security update and minor update. And it's just wrong. So Java 9 has no 1.9.0. Because after 20 years, there will probably never be version 2. So it's just nonsense. And it doesn't have two information, two things in one number. So new scheme is major dot minor dot security, and in long version it's plus build. And we also got this nice little object. In Java doc, can you see it? Which is version object, and you can get major, minor, security. You can compare two versions. You can even parse a version to get instance of this object. And you can get this object from runtime class for your runtime. Okay, so example is first version will be 9, then 9.01, it's first security, second security update, then minor update, and you can always see what's really in there. Okay. Another like minor update in Java 9 is HTML in JavaDoc, and especially, you know how it's hard to find something in JavaDoc, it's basically impossible. And we got nice little input here, and I can search, for example, this, and I get this pop down list, and I can jump right into the class. So it's like minor improvement, but I think it's nice. Some internal change. Java 9 got a new default garbage collector called G1. And G1 is available since Java 7. And by the time it got several improvements and development, so it became default garbage collector in Java 9. And what's important for Java developer is that it's oriented to minimal pauses, so you might expect faster latency, but little lower throughput. And high throughput is what was previous garbage collector oriented. So it was parallel collector that was before garbage collector in previous versions. Annotation deprecated got some improvements. So it has now two elements, which says since when the API was deprecated. It's simple string. And for removal means if it will be removed in next major version of Java. So if compiler shouts to you that you are using some deprecated method, you now know if it's going to be removed. I will do a little demo for you to show new tool here, JDepperScan. So I find my Java 9 and it's a little tool that tells you which classes have something deprecated. So if I do simple list, I can see all deprecations in Java 9. If I do list for removal, I can see all API that's going to be removed in Java 10. So don't use this. Another thing, we got JShell, our REPL for Java, and why we want something like this? I think there are several reasons. If we want to show Java to someone who doesn't know it, you may want to use REPL, because if you start to write in class and there are many buzzwords and you say, or the person who are teaching asks you what's a public class, and you say doesn't matter now, I will just bring the whole world. And there are many buzzwords like that, so you can start a REPL and show Java how Java looks. Or you can learn yourself. You can do some micro testing to explore possibilities of some API, so you can try it.
And JShell got also API. So you can use JShell from your application, and I think it's a way how to, or where new tools may become reality for IDEs and so on. This is how API looks. It's just simple example. So I have a eval function, and I create integer A, integer B, and in integer C I add them together. And then I just print out all variables. Output is totally expected. And just like that, you might expect some tools for your IDE that use this API. Okay, I got a demo. So let's start JShell. And this is how it looks. So I may want to create variable A, but it's not working because, of course, I need integer A. And as you may notice, I'm not using semicolon. That's just not needed, not required for the first time in Java. So let's create B, and I have a variable B. I can, of course, change its value. Now I don't have to use int because it's already declared. And if I do A plus B, it's A. Makes sense. Now I can use some commands for JShell, which start with slash. And if I enter slash B, it prints out all my variables. As you can see, there's some $4, which is, if I don't specify how to save the result, it's just straight some $ and some number increasing the order. I can create methods here, so for example, like this one. And there's the error. Okay, so now I have my method, and I can use at A and B, and I have again 8. I can change, for example, this method by another command, which is edit, and if I type edit at, I got this beautiful IDE, and for example, testing. It's like it jumps out from 90s straight into your face. Okay, so now I zip, and tries that was modified. So now if I called at AB, it's 10 because I edited it to at another 2.
Could you actually take the terminal and make it a bit smaller so that it's not clipped?
Uh-huh. Sorry.
No worries. Thank you.
Okay, I can create classes, for example. I got my class A, and let's edit this again. So So, for example, I can create methods in this class that just prints now I can create instance of my class, and I can see it's some job that I can call now, and it's my as well. Okay, you maybe notice that autocomplete works here, so if I press stop, I can see all my thoughts. Some other commands that you are telling to JShell that start with slash, for example, writes all methods I can use, or all types, so I created class A in types. I can use list, and that's all snippets I entered. I can use history, and it's basically all commands I enter, so even these. I can save everything that I did to file, so for example, file txt. And now if I exit from JShell, I can see the file is here. And content of file is really simple, just commands are entered, and I can again load this file if you see this is empty, and I open the file. You can see that everything was processed. What's interesting is command imports, and there are every packages I can use by default, or I can use, I can import that by hand, or add some jar on class file, for example. Reset for resetting state, and now I'm clean. So this was a really quick demo for JShell, so you have some some image what's JShell about. Some language changes in Java 9. Everything is under Project Coin, which is project that, like, if developers of Java want to introduce some minor change of language, that's like it under Project Coin. So it's now safe works annotation. You can use it on private instance. It was not possible, and it didn't make sense. So it's possible now. You can use effectively final variables in derived resources. I can show you in next slide, I think. You can use Diamond with Animals class, which wasn't also possible, but why not? And you can't use underscore as identifier because it's a new keyword.
Just keyword.
Last change is you can use private methods in interfaces. In Java 8, there was introduced default methods, so just to support them, so you can hide the implementation. Okay, private resources, this is how it looks like in Java 8. You have to create a new variable, and it's closed automatically for you. In Java 9, you don't have to create new variable, you can use just like this or even like this, and it's closed for you. So minor update, same as Diamond. In Java 8 you have to define in this example string here, Java 9 will have to.
Okay. New APIs. There's a lot more, but I choose this one. So I show you in slides or even demos all of them. So it's HTTP client, process API, list map, set pattern methods. Yeah, some new methods in stream and some new methods in optional. So this is. I find it a Stack Overflow, so I don't think it's the best solution. But if you want to do HTTP GET request, that's what you find. And so for so simple things, quite complicated. You have to create some connection, and especially this line is like you have input stream reader, buffer reader, and now you have to do a loop and just some join the result, and it's quite complicated for such a simple task. So in Java 9 we have a new API which looks like this, and it, as you can see, it's much simpler. I just create an HTTP client and I create my request, which is nothing more than just URL GET request, and I'm good. And then I call send on my client and put the request in, and I'm telling that I want to handle response as a string and just call body and I have all I need. So a little demo.
Change the background to white or the theme or whatever.
I can't.
Okay.
I'm sure it's possible, but I don't know how. Maybe.
Preferences and font, I guess.
Sorry?
Preferences and font, I would say. Sorry, color scheme.
There's solarized light, maybe there is this is light.
Oh, very good.
Okay. So as you can see, I hope there's nothing more that was in the slide, but here is HTTP address of my presentation. And I have some stopwatch here, and I just send the request to my presentation, and I write 5 lines of response. So as you can see, it returned 301. So there's easy fix for that. And what I'm saying here is just to the client that I want follow redirects always. So I just say it. Yeah, it returns something. And if I want to do asynchronous request, I can do it just as easy and not call send here, but call send async, and now I get future, and just call get and body, and I have all what I need. if you look at the times, that in the first example, the 400 milliseconds was to send the request, and now it was the 200 milliseconds after I send the request, so it was really synchronous. So, just a simple example of this API. Unfortunately, it's in incubator, and that's also a new thing in Java 9, that if developers of JDK are not sure if the API is ready to production, they put it in incubator, and you just don't know if it will be promoted to official API, or if it will be completely changed or removed. So, unfortunately, I don't recommend to use this API, but it's quite nice. So,
Any idea if it's going to support HTTP 2? Because you've heard it in the headline and you didn't speak about it as far as I remember.
Yes, you can probably read it somewhere here.
It says right there, it implements HTTP 2 and WebSockets. It says.
Yeah, so I guess it should, but I mean. Another new API is Process API, so you can control processes in your operating system. This is how you get all running processes in Java 8, or the Java. You have to execute a command and then somehow parse it. So it's not very good. It's also from Stack Overflow, so I think there are better solutions.
And it's platform specific, moreover.
Mm-hmm.
It works on the Linux lists.
Yeah. So now we got something like this. We got the process handle, and we get all processes just like that, and we get stream of. Stream of all processes, and we can do what we want with them. So another demo. This one. So here I get all processes. I filter the ones that contains top, and I kill them. So I start top, and for example, htop. And it writes that it's killing some two processes, and as you can see, you can get also some info about them, like command line, where it started, and so on. And the processes are really killed. I have another demo, but I don't want to do it now, because it kills all processes, but not Java. I actually didn't try that, so maybe at the end of this presentation, we'll see. I think this is really nice because creating list sets or collections of some variables was really pain, and you had to use special libraries for that, and in general you don't want to do that. So we got some nice filtering methods. I think it's pretty clear. Just here, the map, it's a key, value, another key, second key, second value, third key, third value. And it's basically the same like this. We have some new methods in stream. So, another demo here. Demo in G-shell. If you look at the first method, it takes some seed, and some predicate, and some unary operator. And it looks a lot of like for loop. Look really closely. So you might see it better now, because so first value I got 0. Now I say I want to, if I is less than 10, and just I plus 1. And if I print, it's basically a for loop in stream. The another two methods are...
Can you by any chance make it bold or again change the background, because the symbols now are not very much visible.
Okay. Bold.
Thank you.
Another method is take while, so you can now say that you want to take the elements while it's less than 5, so no more. And very similar method is drop while. And do the same, but from other side. Optional get, I think, 3 new methods, but this one is I'm really excited about, because now I can do if and else at the same line, basically. And it looks just like this. So it's really simple, and I think it's really useful. Okay, how many time we have? So now let's move to the modules, the biggest feature of Java 9. So it's developed under Project Jigsaw, which was started, I think, in 2009, which was still when Java 7 was still under development, so it's a really old project. I think it should be, that project just the modules should be in Java 8, but it was postponed to Java 9, and it's biggest reason for the postponements of Java 9. So it's really big project and big thing in Java. So what are goals of modules and Project Jigsaw? And these are strong encapsulation, reliable configuration, scalability, and I mean scalability down and up. And it does these things in two layers. Say JDK is modularized by the system, and same system is provided for your application. So what you can use, it's actually used in JDK. If I talk mentioned strong encapsulation, I think the Jigsaw fixed this table, because if you look at it, if you take private, It's in class. It's okay. Default, the package, okay. Protected, subclass, okay. But public, it's wrong. And this step is huge. And we basically don't want to do that. So I think that Project Jigsaw fix the table and it will look like this. Yes, if you write public, it's no longer visible to the world, but just to the module. And you have to explicitly export your package to be visible to the world. I put it in quotation marks because it's not modifier keyword, so it's really just in quotation. Okay, so there should be no more class path help. And that's what I meant if I said reliable configuration. And how we go from this? Module path. But we'll see. Module path is basically it replaces class path. And problems with class paths are that everything is allowed there. You can put any jar file and everything is public, everything is available. And you have almost no control what's really loaded and what you are using. So on module path, you can have each module just once. And visible is just what that module exports. And you have to explicitly read on the module to use it. And you have control both compile time and runtime, so you can't. Basically, you have to have just once module both on compile and runtime. So what is module? It's defined by new file, module.info.java, and you can read other modules, you can export your own packages. And this is quite important because I want you to remember that you export packages and you read all module. And if you read other module, you read every packages that other module export. And you can use and provide services. So, last demo on modules. So I have an application here which use Java 9 modules, and to keep it simple now, let's just assume I have some random generator and I generate 10,000 random numbers and it returns to list, and I print how that list is big. And where I get this random generator? It's from another module, which is here. And it's really simple. It just returns random numbers. And here's module info for the app module. And as you can see, I require that random generator. And random generator exports that package. So, I have some simple build script that first compile, then package jar files and run. Compile is nothing unexpected, I think, just Java C, and I specify out there. And here I can see, first for the first time, the module path, especially for more precise model source path, and I define source derivative. And then I just find all Java files. To package, it might look quite complicated, but it's not. I just loop through folders and create jar files. And here I create the jar file for with main class, so it's nothing more. And for run, again, this one, this is not important now. I just run Java, module pass, and then directory where all jar files are, and I specify that I want to run module app and this class. So hopefully it will run. Yes, it writes 10,000. If I modify, for example, module info for app, and I remove this line, I got error in compile time, and it said that that my module does not read it. And same happen if I edit module info in random generator and I don't export my package. So it's exactly or very similar error that the class is not visible. So I have some I have ensured that everything is on place and already in compilement. So I want to show you a very interesting thing which I'm really excited about, and it's new tool called J-Link, and the script to write run J-Link is this. It's new tool, and in a minute or two I will show you what it do. And you again specify module path, and now you put a folder of your Java with modules of JDK and my lib directory, and I add my module up. I specify launcher to be again named app and module app and my class. And I specify outputdir to just somewhere. If I run it now, you can see that here this is my output directory or exec directory. It's this link directory, and you can see that there's bin conf include legal lib. It looks a lot like JDK. And if I enter to my bin directory, there's app, which is Java, Java 9. If I run my app, it writes 10,000. So what J-Link does is that it packs everything what your application needs, and it creates a runtime for you for your application. So there's nothing more. There are all dependencies needed, and you can take this folder, pack it, and deploy.
So is the app actually a binary file? Or is
it's
a
not.
Script?
It's a script that run Java with some parameters.
Okay.
And if I run Java list modules, you can see that there are Java base, which is base module, which you get implicitly in every case. And there's my top module and generator and some others. And if you see, it has 44 megs, so it's not smallest. It's not like if you build it in C, but I think only RTJAR have something about 70 megs. So I think this is really nice. It goes with IoT. You can take this, deploy, and run. So that's all I got.
Can you go two slides back?
Two slides back.
One more. Okay, we have something else. Anyway, you wrote that you can have each module on a module pass in advance. Do you know how it behaves when you have one module depending on module in version 1 and another module is depending on the same module but in version 2? Do you know how it resolves?
Yeah, but unfortunately versions are not solved. So you can't have two versions of same module. So you have to choose.
So it is not a runtime thing, it's not based on class loaders, it is a compile time thing, if I understand it.
It's both. You can, for example, compile with one module and at the runtime put another.
No, I mean, OSGI works the way that you've got class loaders and each module is loaded by a specific or by a class loader. And that's the way how they manage to sort of shield the modules.
The same in API. Each module has its own.
Is it the same thing?
Yeah.
So it should be able to do with versions.
Yeah.
Sure. It isn't. Really, it isn't.
Okay.
If you look on some presentations, it's usual questions how it solves the different versions of the modules. They always say that it's work for Maven or for build system, but not for Java.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, you can see the materials for this presentation, all the demos, and everything on my GitHub. So, there are no more questions?
No more time.
Okay, thank you.